Hi everyone. Good evening. So let's wait for 5 more minutes. We will start the session at 6:05, okay? Let others join.
Hello, hello.
Yes.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes, good evening. Okay, so it's 6:05. Let's start now. I think enough people have joined. So in today's session, we will be discussing the activity and practice questions from week 4, okay? And before we move on to the questions, I would like to discuss some of the concepts from week 4 as well. Let's revise it once more. I know it's been done in the last session. I'll revise that once more. And in the end, if you have any more doubts, I can take that. All right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let me share my screen. Is it visible, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, please let me know if the font is size is okay, like you can read the slides.
Yep.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so this is from lecture 4.3. Before that, I'm just discussing this part because it is important for your practice and graded questions as well. So let's start with this. Okay, so I guess all of you remember what we were doing in this lecture is that basically we were trying to find if there are any two students who have the same birthdays, right? Or more than two students. So that was the first step in this whole week 4. So we actually saw there were like different algorithms that we could use to find that. But we are trying to find the one that is the most optimized, right? So what is the like brute force approach? That you take every card from the pile and match it with all other cards, right? So what we are doing is let us take a smaller data set. Okay. So in our card, we have around 30 cards. So instead of that, let us take 5 cards, for example, A, B, C, D, E, like in this diagram. Okay. So now let us draw a graph. Okay. So if I want to check every card with every other card, okay, you will tell me, will there be an edge from, okay, edges here will represent comparisons. Okay. So tell me, will there be an edge from A to B? Or between A and B, will there be an edge? Say A, B, C, D, E are 5 cards, 5 students. Okay, I want to compare their birthdays. So will there be an edge between A and B?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, between A and D?
Yes, ma'am.
A and C?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And
A and B.
A and E.
Yes, ma'am.
Correct. Will there be an edge between B and C?
Yes, ma'am.
B and E?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
B and
yes, ma'am.
C and D?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
C and E?
Yes.
And D and E?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Will there be one more edge between B and A? Like I drew one from A to B. Will there be one again from B to A?
No,
ma'am.
No, right? Because that is nothing but a duplicate, because this is not an actual graph. We are just comparing two entities, right? Now, don't confuse it with a directed graph. In graphs, if I draw an edge like this, then A to B is different from B to A. But in this case, we are not doing that. We are just representing the comparisons with the help of edges. Right? So, let's check this out. See. So comparing each element with all other elements. So there are total 5 elements. Say I want to compare all 4 other elements with A. So B, C, D, E all have edges with A. Again, what can I have? It's just the same thing that I drew, right? Now we'll draw edges between B and all other nodes that do not have edges with B. Then same goes for C, D. And E, when we move to E, we'll see that it already has edges with all other nodes. Correct, but B with A need not be repeated. That is, if there is an edge between two nodes, we do not need to repeat it. Right? Okay. So this is the basic idea. So how many comparisons will be needed in total? Let's count the number of edges, right? So A will get compared with B, C, D, E. So 4 comparisons, correct? Now B gets compared with C. Again, B gets compared with D, 5, 6. C gets compared with D and E, 7, 8. Correct? B also gets compared with E, and D also gets compared with E. So total 10, right? Now you can go node wise and find out that how many edges each node has. Correct? See, we'll see that every node will have, okay. If I have 5 nodes, right? And I want every node to be compared with every other node. So how many node, like how many edges will be there for each node?
I'm 4.
Correct. So 5 nodes and each node will have 4 edges. What does this mean? We can generalize it to, if we are comparing n nodes, then every node will have n minus 1 edges because it will be compared with n minus 1 other nodes, right? See here also, A also has 4 edges, B also has 4 edges, right? Like this you can check. So there will be a total of 10 comparisons. See, these are the comparisons. A with B, A with C, A with D, A with E, right? Like I drew first. Then you see B with C, B with D, B with E. 3 more, so 4 plus 3. Again, C with D, C with E, 2 more, plus 2. And lastly, D with E, so plus 1. So total 10. So this is clear for everyone how we get 10 comparisons in this case?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now see, here is an interesting thing. All right. So for n objects, the number of comparisons required will be how much? So for n objects, how many comparisons will be required? Here I had 5 objects and I needed 10 comparisons. So there is a formula for this. So if there are n objects, this will be the formula. N into n minus 1 by 2. Okay. This is nothing but the sum of n natural numbers, right? So if I go from 1 to, say, if I have 10 nodes, so what will be my total number of comparisons? Tell me. 10.
Into 10 minus 1 by 2.
45.
First, let's write the formula. 10 minus 1 by 2.
90.
So this is 90 by 2. That is 45. I'll have 45 yes. comparisons if there are 10 nodes. So this is how you can do for any number of nodes. All right. So since in our data set, we had what? 30 students, right? So how many comparisons? 30 into 30 minus 1 by 2.
1, 2.
Okay, you can calculate this. Now see, there is one more way to come to this same conclusion. That is, this is the same as the number of ways of choosing 2 objects from n objects. So if you do this, calculate this NC2, you will reach this n into n minus 1 by 2. Actually, NCR's formula, that is combination formula, is NCR is n factorial by r factorial into n minus r factorial.
Yes.
Correct? This is the formula actually. But if you solve this, you will reach here. Okay. Taking r equals to 2. So this will be your final result. So this is one more way. Because why are we choosing 2 objects from n objects? Because at one time, in one iteration, can we compare more than 2 nodes or 2 cards?
No,
right?
No, ma'am.
So only we are picking any, will... yeah. So we are yes. picking any 2 random cards and comparing, right? So that
yes,
is why
ma'am.
You are choosing 2 cards from n cards. So NC2, right? And this will be the conclusion you will reach. So this is the same thing as this. It's just different ways of reaching the same conclusion.
Yes, ma'am.
There is one more way. Okay. See, this is like the most logical one, this third one. See. So you have n nodes, right? And you want to compare it with, like you want to compare every node with every node, correct? So how many total comparisons will you have? Considering that I'm comparing a node with itself as well. N cross n, right? See
yeah.
in this diagram, if I compared A with all 5, A, B, C, D, E. Again, B with all 5, A, B, C, D. So how many will I have? 5 cross 5? Right? 5 cross 5 comparisons? Pairs?
Yes, sir.
So, in that way, if I generalize it to n, then total number of pairs will be n cross n, right? But this is not the correct approach because we are doing what? Extra comparisons. From this, we have to reduce the self comparison. Self comparison means this A cross A or B cross B. We don't need to compare a node with itself, right? Obviously, those are redundant. So, we will reduce them. Now, how many such self pairs will be there if I have n nodes? If I have n nodes, how many self pairs?
N self-pairs.
Right. So N self-pairs that we have to remove. So N cross N minus N. Get it? Second step clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I can write this as this. So I'm just taking N common, right? What will that leave me? N minus N into N minus 1. Right? From this.
Yeah.
So this is the third
step.
Sir. Now also we are not done. Because what are we doing? We are not taking the comparisons one. So if we are having one comparison, A with B, we are again doing the same thing, B with A. But that is also redundant, right? We only need one comparison between A and B. Because A with B and B with A will give the same result. Correct? So what do I have to do? So for every pair of nodes, I am actually doing double the work that I need to do, right? So what will I do? I will just divide by 2. Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Because for every comparison, we are for every pair of cards, we are actually doing 2 comparisons. One from A to B, one from B to A. But I just need one because both of those will give the same result. So I will do N into N minus 1 by 2. That is, I will reduce it by half. So this will be my final number of comparisons needed. Clear, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All three principles clear? See, all of them will reach the same conclusion. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Right.
So number of comparisons can be written like this. Half into N minus 1. Okay. Now this formula is very important for your week 4. Right? Remember this. Now see how the number of comparisons can grow very fast. It can grow exponentially, right? Yeah. Are you saying something?
Yes, ma'am. Some background noises are coming from your side.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm in the office actually. If it gets very loud, let me know. Otherwise, I don't have much choice. You can still hear me, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. If it gets too much, you let me know. I will see what I can do. So let's check this, how this number of comparisons grows really fast. So if I have only 2 cards, how many comparisons will I need? 1. Why? 2 into 2 minus 1 into half.
Yeah.
That is 1.
Yes.
Similarly for 3, you will get 3. Yes. 4, you will get 6. See, up to this, even up to 7, 8, 9, 10, the number of comparisons increase in a moderate way. But after that, it will start increasing in a, like it will grow exponentially. All right. See, in 10, at 10, it is 45 comparisons. But at 100, it is 49,500. And when we go up to 1,000, you will see it is somewhere near 5 lakhs. Right. So this is how, this is why we do not want N squared. Okay. So if any of you ever reads about complexities in algorithms, you will see that N squared complexity is not desirable because N squared means it takes a lot of time. So if you have 1,000 cards, that means your computer will need to perform 5 lakh comparisons. Now, if one comparison, I'm saying in a much bigger term, say if one comparison takes 1 second, it doesn't. It takes much less time than that. If it takes 1 second, that means it will take 5 lakh seconds, right? That is why you never want complexities that are exponentially increasing. Okay, so N squared is not usually desirable. That is why we try to keep the number of comparisons to minimal. Clear, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, this will be the curve. See how it is increasing? See, as the number of comparisons increase, it will increase drastically, right? There is no downward curve.
Yeah, uniformly.
Yeah. So how do we reduce the number of comparisons? This is our key idea. Our idea is to reduce it to the minimal. How will we do that? See. So the idea we use is called binning, which is nothing but, say, dividing our cards or nodes, whatever you want to call it, into bins, right? So there's an even better idea of looking at it is you have a big problem, you're breaking it down into smaller problems, all right? That is, you have a big data set, you want to break it down into smaller data sets and then apply the same algorithm only to find your result. Okay, but it will take much less time. How, we will see. So if I have 9 nodes or 9 objects, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. So using that previous formula, how many comparisons should we get? 36, right? Half into 9 into 8.
What is the formula again?
N into n minus 1 by 2.
By 2.
So 36 comparisons. What we are doing, we are grouping them in threes. So we are actually taking three bins, each of which have a capacity of 3. Right? And in based on something, like some parameter is there based on which we are dividing that which node will go into which bin. So let's just say that it is like just equal size bins, and one bin has ABC, one has DEF, one has GHI based on some parameter. Okay.
Yes.
So this is one bin, this is one bin, this is one bin. Now the objects can be binned into three bins of three each. So what will be the number of comparisons per bin? See, I am not changing the fundamental idea. It is still that same comparison we are doing. But now the number of comparisons will be less. How? Because in each bin, we will have three objects. So half into 3 into 2.
Yes, ma'am.
That is three comparisons per bin.
Yes, ma'am.
So if you do three comparisons per bin, that means you have three bins. So total how many comparisons? 3 cross 3, 9. But if we took all of them together, 36. So what is the factor by which your comparisons just got lessened? 4, right?
Yes,
4 times. So 36 yes, by 9. So binning reduced your complexity or number of comparisons 4 times.
But it is not comparing A and G like that.
We will see. So that is the parameter based on which we did the binning, right? It is not done randomly. So when you are dividing these nodes into bins, right, they are following some criteria such that we won't need to compare A with G. You just need to compare the elements in each bin. We'll take an example, okay? But there is some criteria based on which we divide them into separate bins. So binning did what? Decreased your number of comparisons 4 times, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So it is reduced by a factor of 4 times. So if somebody asks you, what will say some question is there that earlier we were performing 100 comparisons, now we are performing 25 comparisons. So what is the factor by which my number of comparisons is reduced? That means 100 by 25.
4.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Now let's see calculation of reduction due to binning. So for n items without binning, how many comparisons? This. N into n minus 1 by 2. Now, if we use k bins, like in the last example, we use 3 bins, right, of equal size. So number of items in each bin is how many? I have n items, I have k bins of equal size. So each bin has how many? N by k?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So number of comparisons per bin, now nothing. Just replace this n with n by k, right? Because now I'm performing this same algorithm for each bin. So n is now replaced by n by k because each bin has n by k elements. So half into n by k minus 1. Clear up to this? Any issue?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, yeah.
N k minus 1.
I have n items, okay? And I have k bins, all equal sized bins.
Yes.
Say I have 9 items and I have 3 bins. So each bin can hold 3, right? So earlier, without binning, I had to do how many comparisons? Half into 9 into 9 minus 1. So now within each bin, 36. How many comparisons? Yeah. So within each bin, how many?
36.
Half into 3 into 3 minus 1?
Into 3.
So this 3 is what? N by k, that is 9 by 3.
Oh.
So yes, that yes, n by yes, k ma'am. Only I'm writing here for generalization.
Yes, ma'am.
Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, Kiran.
What is the use of binning?
Binning reduces the number of comparisons required. Okay? So that you can perform your computations faster. So earlier, if I did it without binning, I had 9 objects, I would need to do 36 comparisons. But with binning, I only need 9. 3 bins, 3 comparisons each, 3 plus 3 plus 3, 9. Okay? So total number of comparisons, yeah, go on.
Total number of comparisons will be same.
How will it be same? So total number of comparisons is number of bins into comparisons per bin, this, right? So that will give you this half into n by k minus 1. This k gets cancelled out. Is this same as half into n minus 1? No, right? This is way more.
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, factor of reduction is what? This half into n minus 1 by half into n by k minus 1. That is basically the number of comparisons you are performing without binning by number of comparisons performed with binning. So,
yes.
Just to be clear, just write it down. Factor of reduction is what? Number of comparisons without binning by number of comparisons with binning, or rather, right, total number of comparisons with binning, because you might do this that you just calculate number of comparisons per bin and you divide it by that. No, you have to calculate the total number of comparisons, like take all the bins, right? That is why into k. So this you can remember this much, right?
Yes.
So this will be the final expression, n minus 1 by n by k minus 1. If you can remember it, great. If you cannot, no problem. It is better always to derive by yourself. Okay. So for n equals to 9, k equals to 3, we saw n minus 1 by 3 minus 1 gives 4. Or you can just calculate this half into n minus 1. Because in exam, you have a lot of things to remember, right? So it is better not to memorize useless formulas. You can just derive them yourself. So 36 by 9 will also give you 4 through reduction by a factor of 4 times.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is the summary. The number of comparisons between all pairs of items grows quadratically. That is quite fast. We saw the graph. The formula of number of comparisons for n items is half into n minus 1. Sometimes it is possible to find a heuristic that allows us to put the items into bins and compare only items within the bins. So this that we talk about, find a heuristic, means what? That we can find some condition, some parameter based on which we can put the items into bins. That is based on which we can separate the items into separate groups, right? Bins are nothing but groups. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, so, ma'am.
Based on some formula or some condition, some parameter, you can divide those items sometimes. So if there are n items to put into k bins of each of equal size, all bins are of equal size, right? And I have n items, then the number of comparisons reduces to half into n by k minus 1. This is total number of comparisons with binning. Derived from what? K into half into n by k into n by k minus 1. Right? Just solve this and you will get this. Nothing. Just kk cancel out. That's it. So factor of reduction, n minus 1 by n by k minus 1. If you don't want to remember this, just solve this by this. And you're done. Okay?
Yes.
So I hope this much summary is okay. Now we can go on to the actual question part. Activity questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you people, any of you have any doubts from the theory part? You can ask me from week 4. No? Okay. Let us do the activity questions, and if there we can clear all the doubts. Wait, let me share. Is it visible, my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So everyone has watched the lectures, at least started anything?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So when is the deadline for the graded? I think it's 21st.
21st.
Yeah, right, 21st. So before that, what are your tasks? Watch all the tutorials, all the lectures, go through all the activity questions, all the practice questions, then attempt the graded. And before attempting the graded, clear all your doubts, ma'am, from activity and practice. Yeah.
Ma'am, yeah. Quiz first is going to be held on 25th.
Yeah.
So we'll contain the
It will contain which one
contents
to four?
Are not.
No, only one to four.
Only yeah. one to four. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so before doing the graded, you will complete all the activity and practice and ask all your doubts. Clear everything, then complete.
Ma'am, after quiz one week, can we submit the graded assignment week 5?
You can submit graded assignment for week 5 under whatever the deadline is. I think it's 28.
Yeah, 28.
Yeah, so by 28 you can submit.
Then why is that week 5 released? Because
it is released because the course is of 12 weeks, right? So we have to follow that order only. We cannot skip a week just because of there is a quiz. So you have to give quiz exams in between your other week assignments only.
But we will be qualified after giving qualifier exam only.
Yeah, so you can start doing that. What I can say is that give your best so that you do qualify, right? We have to release the content for other students who are term students, right? So do your best quiz. You can qualify if you just do whatever we have taught in the sessions. That is more than enough to qualify the quiz.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Is it related to all the questions like that or like the level of the questions?
Level of questions will be nothing more than what you have done in your practice and graded from weeks 1 to 4. Okay, that is why I'm saying that practice all the questions that you have done till now. And do not skip any of the activities or practices just because they don't have points, because they will carry weightage when you are writing that exam. You'll understand all the concepts will be from there only.
Okay.
So everyone just do your best. Okay, it is not a hard exam. Okay.
Exam model will be like these graded assignments.
Sorry?
Questions will be...
Ma'am, how much question will be there?
You won't get direct questions from assignment, right? But yeah, questions on similar concepts will be.
Ma'am, hello.
All questions will be from whatever you have practiced in.
Number of questions, ma'am, I'm asking.
10 to 15.
Yeah, 10 to 15 questions.
For each course, 10 to 15.
Yeah. Okay.
So we'll get weekly mock.
Mocks. Okay, yeah. I'm not sure about mock exams, but you can ask on Discourse. I guess we can reply there.
I'm a qualifier student.
Okay.
Ma'am.
So yeah.
PRD cap is not opening in my portal, ma'am.
Yeah. Some people are having that problem. I have asked you, sir, about it. It will be resolved. Don't worry.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah.
In from graded assignment week 4, question week number four, 7.
One second. So week 4 graded we cannot discuss right now.
Yes, ma'am. But I have a question in question error there.
Okay. Yes. If you think there is an error, please write it on Discourse, because in session we cannot take up graded right now, right? So after 21st you can ask in session, or before that, if you think there is an error in a question, you can put it on Discourse. We will discuss there.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, practice and graded assignment would be enough for passing the qualifiers, right?
Yes, provided that you have gone through the lectures.
Yeah, I mean, if I would score
if
maximum.
If you have good score in graded assignments, then yeah, sure.
Okay.
How many questions are there in total?
10 to 15.
For all subjects?
I'm talking about CT. Other all subjects I do not know, but around that only, 10 to 15 only you will get, because the timing is also less, right? You won't have that much time. Okay, so any other query if you have regarding quiz, you can ask on Discourse. Let us first complete this activity questions, right? So activity 4.1. So you people are acquainted with that birthday paradox problem, right? Nested iterations using the birthday paradox problem. Is everyone acquainted, or do I need to discuss this?
Ma'am, please discuss.
Okay. So before, one thing I will request everyone is that before coming to the sessions, please try to at least go through a little bit of the lectures, okay? I know that there are 3 sessions, so you have enough time in between to go through the lectures. If you do that, it will be easier for you as well as us. So what is the birthday paradox? It is that we had in that data set, we had around 30 cards for students, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So what we want to find is actually it is said that if you have, say, even a small data set of 25 to 50 people, so it is very much possible that there will be pairs of people having the same birthday in that data set. Okay. So that is what we are trying to check here. That in our data set, there are only 30 people. So we are trying to check that if there are such pairs present who have the exact same birthday. Now, we do not have the year of birth given in our data set, right? We only have the date and the month. Correct? This yes, is the format in which it is given, the birthday. You can check. So we are trying to find this same date month pair. Okay. There can be more than one student. There can be more than two students having the same birthday, but we are currently trying to find a pair. Okay. Yes. So what do you think is the most naive approach to do it? I have a deck of 30 cards. So first card I will pick up, right? So first card, say this is my first card, card one. Say her birthday is 30th May. Now I have 29 more cards left in my pile.
Screen got stuck.
Sorry, I didn't share my entire screen. One second. Okay, now is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I was saying that I have 30 cards, right, in my deck. And this is the date month is the format of the birthdays given in each card. We do not know the year. Okay. So say this is my card one that I pick up from my deck. And say this person has birthday 30th May. Now what am I trying to do? I have 29 more cards left. My job is to see if anyone among these 29 people have the same birthday. That is 30th May. So that is what I'm trying to do. So what is the most naive brute force approach? I have to match this card with all 29 cards, right? Just like what we were doing till now. We were doing what? If I had n cards, how many comparisons was I having? N into n minus 1 by 2? Yeah, that is exactly what we're doing here, right? So I have 30 cards. So 30 into 29 by 2, right?
Yes.
So this is the birthday paradox, right? So if you go through the common data, you will see that there will be a pair of students who have the same birthday. You can spend some time and work it out. So now this problem is asking, one second. Yeah, so this question is asking what? We can always find at least one pair of students with same date of birth in a single iteration. Now see, so first when I pick this first card, right, see, I can write if, or better to say, while more cards in pile one. Okay, so while more cards in pile one, I will pick a card. What I will do, I will again enter and I will again run one more while loop, which will do what? It will pick cards from the other 29 cards. Okay. So in this while loop, we'll pick cards from the other 29 cards, not this one included. Because remember when I was saying that all self pairs must be excluded, correct? So I cannot take this card, I will take from this 29 cards. So there will be a nested iteration. Okay, this outside iteration, say I picked the first card using this outside iteration. So inside how many times the loop will iterate? Inside loop for each card outside? 29 times. So how many times will the outer loop iterate?
One time.
So, all total how many?
That is 30.
30 times?
Yes.
It will go through every card, right?
Yes.
So it will check one card first. Now for that card, it will check all 29 cards. again it will take a second card, and for that card it will check the other 29 cards. So for every card it checks all other cards. So there are total 30 into 29 by 2 iterations, correct? Or comparisons. Why by 2? Because of that same thing, that if I'm comparing A with B, I do not need to compare B with A.
Yeah.
Clear, everyone, how the iteration is working?
Yes.
So this is the naive approach.
Yes, ma'am.
So what is our question asking? We can always find at least one pair of students with same date of birth in a single iteration. Is it possible?
No.
Single iteration is never possible, right? We need to do a nested iteration.
Yes.
Okay. So that is why it will be false. So two nested iterations are sufficient to find pairs of students with same date of birth.
Yes, it's true. Yeah.
I just told you how. Just do a nested loop and you can compare every card with all other cards. So this will be true. Now the third question is,
ma'am, for first question.
Yeah.
Like it can happen out of the blue for once time.
Is it ever possible to do it in one iteration?
It may happen, like rarely.
Yeah, so always it won't happen, right? It can be one case.
Yeah, it cannot happen always. Okay.
It can be one case that you picked up one card and you're extremely lucky that the next card also has same birthday. Yeah, that is why since always word is mentioned, so it is false.
Okay,
now the third question. Statement one. Read the statements carefully. So student X is compared with another student Y from pile one. Okay. Statement two is repeat statement one until pile one is empty. That means we are comparing student X with every student from pile one, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And what is statement three? The date of birth of student X does not match with any other student in pile one. So these three statements are true. Okay. So based on these, choose the correct option. I have solved all of these, so you already see the answer, but still. So both X and Y can be discarded from the deck. Is this correct? Like after I have done this, right? After I have done this, I have completed all, say I have 30 cards. So student X is the first card and I am comparing it with all 29 other students. And after doing that whole comparison, I have found that X does not have a birthday twin. Right, that is no other student shares his birthday. So does that mean I can discard both X and Y from my deck of cards? Like pile one, I will remove both of them from pile?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Why?
Ma'am, we have to keep these cards for other comparisons.
So we need them for other cards to compare with other cards, right?
Yes.
So we cannot discuss even one of them. Is that true? Or can we?
Ma'am, we can discard.
No, I'm saying
exactly. So
one,
we can discard X, right? Because we already checked for X that X does not have a birthday twin. So I do not need to check other cards with X because I already know that X does not have matching birthdays with any other card. So I can discard X, but I have to keep Y.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So X we can discard and keep Y for further iterations. So option D is the correct option. Any problem from 4.1 activity?
No, ma'am.
Okay, great. Let's go to 4.2. So this activity is for that part, binning. Okay. So binning concept is clear to everyone, right? Before we start this.
Yes, ma'am.
How we reduce the winning, that part is not clear. That, for example, that if we want to, how many winning I can understand that if there are four comparison, how many winning here to take, but how to reduce that winning by the that factor, that part is not understood by the lecture.
How winning reduces number of comparisons?
Yes, that part.
Okay, I'll explain it one more time. See, I have 9 objects with me. Okay. 9 objects. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. Okay.
Yes.
I have not introduced binning yet. So I am just doing comparisons among all of them together. So total number of comparisons without binning. Tell me how many.
Nine objects with another nine objects.
Nine into eight.
Among this whole nine objects, I am comparing this every object with every other object. So how many total comparisons?
81.
No. I do not want self pairs, right?
Yes,
I can't have self pairs. So I also cannot have what? If I have checked A with B, I won't check B with A again.
9 into 8 by 2, ma'am.
Exactly. So half into 9 into 9 minus 1. This is how much? 36.
36.
Right? This is without binning.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we introduce binning. So say there is some criteria. Okay. Let's say we are grouping A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. So there are nine students, these nine objects. So I am grouping them by their birth month. Okay. Let's say A, B, C was born in January, D, E, F was born in February, and G, H, I was born in March. So this is the criteria based on which I'm doing the grouping or binning. Okay. Yes. So A, B, C will be in one bin. Right, DEF in another bin and GHI in a third bin.
Excuse me, total, it is not be equal number of elements in a bin, ma'am,
because each bin has equal size. All the bins are equal size.
Is that is the criteria, or we should it is must and should that?
No, I am just taking I am just taking a criteria here to make you understand why ABC is together. That's it. This will not always be the criteria, but yeah, there will be some criteria when we do the binning. It will be given.
Okay.
And mostly the bins might not have equal size as well, because it won't always be right that if in even in your data set, it won't always be like in every month same number of people were born. Correct. So if we are doing binning by that criteria, then obviously each bin might not have the same size or same number of elements.
Ma'am, we are binning based on the same characteristics, like if A, B, same.
Whenever you are binning, based on the same criteria.
Oh, yes.
So for every object, you will check that criteria. Like if you check the lectures, if you go through them, you'll see that sir is doing what? Professors are taking all the cards and they are binning by birth month. So based on that, in some month, there is only one card. That is only one student, say, was born in May. But there were five students born in December. So in that case, in the May bin, there is only one element. But in the December bin, there are five elements, right? So yes, it's not necessary that in every bin, same number of elements will be present. In this example, I'm taking it just for symmetry. That's it.
Yes, got it.
Okay. So let's say these are my three bins. Okay. That who was asking that boy? Okay, you are understanding, right?
Yes, ma'am. Understanding.
So now in each bin, tell me how many comparisons will I have to perform in each bin? How many?
Now, ma'am.
Yes, now. Just tell me in this ABC bin, if I am trying to find that same thing, if there is any person, any pair of people who have the same birthday, that is, say this is the January bin, right? And I am trying to see if any of them were born on the same date in January. Then how many comparisons will I have to perform?
Three.
How did you find that?
Three into two divided by two.
Yeah. So half into three into two, right? So three. So now tell me, this will be the same for these two bins also, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So total, how many comparisons do I have to perform?
Three times three, nine.
Nine. So this is comparisons with binning and this is without binning. So what is the factor by which comparisons are reduced? 36 by 9, that is four times?
1 by 4.
So now is it clear how binning reduces number of comparisons?
Yes, but that formula is written, the factor of reduction is n minus 1.
Okay, that one you're not clear. Okay, see.
That one.
So, the normal formula, you know, right? So total number of comparisons without binning by total number of comparisons with binning. This is your factor formula.
Yes, ma'am.
So total number of comparisons without binning is what?
N into n minus 1 by 2.
Yeah, let's write it down properly. Okay. So this. And by with binning is k into half into n by k into n by k minus 1. Right? This is right?
Yes.
Any confusion?
No.
Right? So k I can cancel out. Okay.
Yes.
Half I can cancel out. From numerator and denominator, I can, right?
Yes.
NN, can I cancel out? Possible? Yes or no?
Yes. No, ma'am.
Why not? This N and this N I can't cancel. After I cancel out K and K, this is just an N left here and there is an N here. Can I cancel them?
Yes, ma'am.
I can, right?
Yes, ma'am, cancel.
Just like 4 by 4. I can cancel the 4s, right? From numerator and denominator. Just like that. So all of this part will be cancelled out. Because, okay, just see simply, na? There is a K here, there is a K here. After I cancel these K's, what is left? Half N here also and half N here also. So this I can cancel out, right? So what is left? N by 1 by N by K minus 1.
Down denominator part, how you have written that K into 1 by 2, K by 2 N divided by that.
So you just did this thing. This is what? See, I had here total, here my N was 9, right?
Yes.
How many bins I had? 3. So K is 3?
Yes.
So what was the this 3 that you are getting here? How were you getting this? By doing N by K? 9 by 3? Right?
Yes.
That is number of elements in each bin. So that is the exact thing I have written. See, half into N by K into N by K minus 1. This 2 you are getting by doing N by K minus 1. That is 9 by 3 minus 1, 2.
Yes.
Now is it clear how I got this formula?
Yes, ma'am.
It is just the generalization. Here N is nothing but total number of objects and K is nothing but total number of bins.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope this factor is clear now for everyone. How I'm reaching this? Any other confusion? Tell me now.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, here, number of bins and the number of comparison in the bin are same. So do we have to like?
In this case, it is, but not always it will be.
Okay.
That is what I said, that not always in every bin you will have the same number of elements. This I have done just for you to understand easily, so that it has some symmetry. When you go through the lectures, you will see that every bin will not have same number of elements. Just like I explained, now that not all, like in all months, not every month will have same number of people having their birthdays in it, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so back to the questions. What first question is, what are the possible binning strategies to find pairs of students with same date of birth? So I have in our cards, what are the things that I am given? One thing is, I am given the birth month and I am given the birth date. The birth year is not given. So out of these four options, I know I have already marked the correct ones. So you tell me, which ones can I use as my binning criteria? Month I can use, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So if I use also. Month, yeah. So if I use month, how many bins will I have at most? 12 bins.
12
why, did bins say, why did I say at most?
Because ma'am, it may have that many months are not included, that many.
See, in our like data set, in our data set, right? It can happen that say students have their birthdays in all 11 months, but say in the month of July, no student has a birthday, right? So in that case, that I don't have to consider.
Yes.
So then I have 11 bins, but yeah, you will have 12 bins because it is symmetrical. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So if I bin by the day of birth, how many at max bins possible?
4. 365.
No.
It will be 7, ma'am.
No. Say, day means I am asking
31 at most.
Yeah,
31. Day means I'm not asking Monday, Tuesday, okay? I'm asking
first
Jan or second Feb, like that. So 31 at most?
Yes, ma'am. At most 31st, because a month contain more, not more than 31st. Yes, yeah,
exactly.
Got it.
Okay. So these are the two criteria. Can I do the binning by city or town? Will that give me, will that help me out to find the same birthday?
No, ma'am.
No.
Or range of total marks, that too. These have no role to play with a birthday, right?
Yes, ma'am.
These two are the correct options. Now, second one, if a bin has at most one card, then there is no need to iterate that bin. Now, if inside a bin I only have one card, say only one person was born in July, do I need to check whether he has any birthday twin?
No.
I already know he does. No, I do not need to go into the loop, right? So in that case, what happens? See, how will the iteration work? So I will write. So first was what? While more cards in pile one, right? And inside the while loop where we were iterating it with every other card, here when it checks in that bin, in that July bin, there will not be any more cards in that pile, right? Because there is only one card. So that iteration will never be fulfilled, correct?
Yeah.
Therefore, no iteration is needed when there is only one card.
Ma'am, but for this, like to check whether any other date of birth is in the July month or not, we have to check for the other iterations. Like we have to go for the other iteration and check
here,
for the other cards.
You have to come into the nested while, but there you won't find any more cards
yes.
left. So you will check, but that iteration will not be performed. Like the comparison will not be performed, right? After you check this condition, it will be false. So you will exit the while loop.
Okay, ma'am. Like it's not going to the first pile, like
see,
first while, first loop. First loop.
No. See, first, okay. Here pile one is what? Here pile one is the number of cards in month of July. Okay. So there is only one card present. So when you go to the first while loop, you check and yeah, there is one card. So yeah, you pick that card. But when you come into the nested loop, what we are doing to avoid self pairs, we remove that card from that pile, right? And check the rest of the pile.
Yes.
So you won't find any more cards.
Yes.
So this will be false condition
no,
and you will exit.
No.
So no comparisons or no iterations
yes.
are needed. Okay.
Yes.
So if a bin has at most one card, no need to iterate. True? Next is,
yes,
one iteration is sufficient to bin the cards. Is this true or false? What do I mean by bin the cards?
Like a category, divide the category. So
yes. So to categorize the cards.
One condition is okay.
So that
yes.
is one iteration is enough, right? By one condition checking only,
yes,
I can tell who is in which month. Right. I'm
mm-hmm.
not. I'm not talking about comparison. Just categorizing who is in which month, whose birthday is in which month. That I can do by one iteration. Okay.
Ma'am, just like
yeah.
the first question. Just like the upper one, like third one, if there is only one student, no, third one.
Yeah.
There is only one student in the July month, for example. So in this bin, there is only one student.
Yeah.
So it will contain
the
only
July
one,
month
one
bin.
Student.
Yeah.
Hmm.
But okay. if I am taking all the students together and I'm just doing my binning, so in that case, only one while loop will be enough. Like, I only need to go through all the cards
yes.
once and I can categorize, right?
Yes.
That is what it's asking.
Yes,
now, fourth is, we can solve the birthday paradox problem after binning in one iteration. Is that true?
No.
No. I have to compare just within the bins. So that nested loop will still be there, but within the bins now, right? Like, for each bin, now I will iterate. First, I was iterating, taking the whole set. Now I have divided it into bins, but I'm still following the same procedure of comparison, just within each bin. So of course not, it won't be there in one iteration, right? Within each bin, we'll iterate multiple times to compare all the cards, right? And only when a bin has more than one card, then only iteration will even occur, right?
Yes.
Ma'am,
yeah.
Ma'am, can you explain fourth one, please, once again?
Yeah, see. So after binning, right? So at first I had this whole set, say A, B, C, D, F, G, H, I. So here when I was performing a number of iterations using that nested while, right? This type of a loop. So after I have binned them into three bins like this, okay. But within each bin, I am again doing this thing only, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So is it possible to find all the pairs of students who have the birthdays on same day with just one iteration?
No, ma'am, no.
No, right? I have to perform separate iterations for separate bins?
Yes, ma'am.
And even inside that, even inside each bin, I have to perform more than one iteration if there are 2, 3, 4 cards present.
Yes, ma'am.
That's it. That's what it's asking. So this will be false.
What is the difference between iteration and comparison?
Okay. So when I talk about iteration, it means every time the while loop is running. Okay. Every time the inside while loop is running and every time the outside while loop is running. Those are different iterations. So for every iteration of the outer while loop, the inner while loop will iterate n minus 1 times. That is excluding that card, all other cards I am comparing it with. Now within that inner, okay, let me share. See, within this inner while, I am performing the comparison. That is, I am matching the dates. Okay, that is your comparison, whatever I'm doing within this while block. But these are the iterations. Every time a while loop iterates, that is an iteration. That is, every time your value changes, every time you pick up a new card, that is an iteration. Okay. And every time you compare the card's values, that is the birthdays, that is your comparison.
Okay. Means iteration means like going through the cards and not
going
seeing
through the cards.
Any conditions and all.
Yeah.
But in comparison, we have a condition. Iteration.
So once you satisfy the condition, only then you are entering the while loop. That is, only if you have more cards left in your pile, only then you are entering this block.
Yeah.
Right. So that is inside the block, inside the nested while, you have your comparison. But every time the while loop is picking up a new card, that is an iteration.
Okay.
Okay. That is why it said that you do not need any iteration if there is only one card, because this nested while will give you false value because there won't be any more cards left. Right, that is why no comparison will happen, because you won't be able to enter this block only.
Mm-hmm.
Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So what is the advantage of binning? Simple, it reduces the number of comparisons. We already seen it. Does it avoid nested iterations?
No.
No.
Because within each bin, we are doing that same thing, nested iterations only. And if you are very smart, you will point out this answer, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So now that's up to you. Okay. Any other? 1 second.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So any problem with this one, activity 4.2?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
So 4.3, we can move on.
Yes, ma'am.
See, in this whole week, there is just this concept of binning only. Okay. If you understand binning, you can answer any question from this week. So we have n cards in a pile, right? We compare each card with every other card in the pile exactly once. So what is the total number of comparisons that we make? This
n into n minus 4.
Yeah.
Yes,
I have already said this 100 times, right? In this lecture.
Yes.
So n into n minus 1 by 2. Just remember this expression. You don't even have to remember. For n cards, I have to exactly compare with all other cards once. So for n cards, I will compare every card with n minus 1 cards, but once. So divide by 2. That is, if I compare A with B, no need to compare B with A. That is why by 2. Okay. Second question. If we connect each element with every other element by lines, what is the total number of lines that we would have to draw? These are my 7 elements. Okay, let's do this here. You will help me draw this.
Also 7 into 6 upon 2.
Yeah, I'm just very good. So I'm just going to draw this one so that you understand better. Don't forget.
Yes, thank you. This is the simple formula used here.
Yeah, but let's see where that formula comes from, right? Again, so A will have edges with everything.
Yes, ma'am.
A will have edges with B, C, D, E, F, G. let's just put arrows to make it simpler. They are all comparing with A. So all the arrows are coming back to A. Again, B will have edges with A again.
No, ma'am.
No?
Not to A, ma'am. Not to A.
But to C?
Yes, ma'am.
C, D, E, F, G, everything?
Yeah, yes, ma'am. F, G.
Oh, sorry, I drew the arrows in the wrong direction. Doesn't matter. But the edges will be there. Now C will have arrows with D.
D.
It's a little messy.
Yes.
E, F, G.
Yes.
D will have with
E, F, G.
Okay, let's just write down first. Okay, so A had with how many? Six others, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Six comparisons. B had with five others.
Five
comparisons. C had with four.
Four.
D, four comparisons.
D has with
four.
Yes.
E, no.
Three.
Yes.
Three.
So D has three. E has with F and
only
G.
F and G.
Two
men.
Two men.
So G. E has two.
And F will has have
with
F
G
and
only.
One comparison.
Only G.
And G has nothing.
G has nothing. G is already compared with every other.
Yes.
Self comparison. Yes.
So how many total? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6. This is what?
21.
Total? 21.
21.
And what is 21. This? Where is this coming from? Simple. A sum of natural numbers formula.
N into N minus 1.
Yes.
Okay, so here
N into N minus 1 by 2.
What is N here?
7, number of competition. Number of competition, N, 7.
So, 7 into?
7 minus 1
7 minus 1 by 2. Number of objects, not comparisons. Okay, this 7 is number of objects.
Yes,
I had 7 objects here. So, this gives us 42 by 2. That is 21. Clear? You can solve any question like this now.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, here, but in here question, A, B, C, D all in one line. So, one line can, but
that
we are
matter.
Comparing
that
with A, B, C, and D, different line means.
There is nothing about lines. It is just written in this way. You can write it all in one line. It doesn't matter. Okay.
Ma'am, down it's written in the question that every other element by lines, what is the total number of lines that we have to draw?
When it is saying we connect each element with every other element by lines, means we draw edges. Lines means edges between two elements, like I drew. There is nothing to do with ABCD is in one line and EFG is in another line. I can write them wherever I want. I can write them in a circle if I want to. Okay. Lines means edges. These things that I drew, now, these are one lines, edges. Okay. That is what they're asking. So 21. I hope this is clear, everyone.
Yes, ma'am.
Now this one you will solve. Good thing I haven't solved it. You will solve this. So assume that a computer can do 10 to the power 8 comparisons in a second. Just keep your cool and read the question carefully. 10 to the power 8 comparisons in 1 second. How many seconds will it take for the computer to do pairwise comparisons of 1 million elements? Okay.
5,000.
Yeah, 5,000. That is the correct answer. Let's solve it for everyone now. Okay. So this is 1 million, 10 lakhs, right?
Yes.
This is the N. Okay.
Yes.
Let's just to make this simple, let us say N is equal to 10 to the power 6. Correct? Because there are 6 zeros.
Yes.
So 10 to the power 6. Okay. Now it is saying I need to perform comparisons between all of them. So I will take my regular formula, half into N minus 1. So this will come up to what? Half into 10 to the power 6 into 10 to the power 6 minus 1. Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now let me just, for simplification and approximation, let me write. Can I ignore this one compared to all the, like, the value that is here? I know it is not totally ignorable, but in terms of powers of 10, I can ignore this one, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Just to make calculations simpler. So if you want to write it, okay, let me write one more step.
It's not perfect anymore.
Yeah. So if you want to write one more line, I will still write it. Okay. So this 10 to the power 6, I can break it into this, right? 10 into 10 to the power 5. This is the same thing as 10 to the power 6.
Yes.
And inside, I am writing this. Okay. Now, I can divide this 10 by 2. It will give me 5.
Yes.
Correct? Okay. Now, let us say that I am ignoring this one because it won't affect the complexity of or the time taken to run the program by a big factor. It is very negligible because it is just 1 and these are 10 to the power 11 if you count it. 10 to the power 5 into 10 to the power 6. So, taking 1 from that won't affect much. So, what do I have now? 5 into 10 to the power 11, right? 5 plus 6, laws of indices, correct?
Mm-hmm.
10 to the power 5 into 10 to the power 6 gives 10 to the power 5 plus 6, correct? So, this 10 to the power 11, so this is the answer. This is how many comparisons we will need approximately if I have 1 million elements, right? Yes,
right.
No. Okay. How many comparisons can my computer perform in 1 second?
10 to the power 8.
Or 8.
And this is the number of comparisons I have. So how many seconds will it take?
5,000.
Divided by 10 to power 8.
This divided by 10 to power 8.
Oh. Correct. What will this 5, give 000. Me? 10 power 3. That 5, is 5,000. 5,000 yes. Seconds. This is your answer. Nearly 5,000. Why nearly? Because I approximated that one.
Can you show please again the solution of question number 3?
Sorry?
Can you show me the solution of question number 3?
Question number 3, yeah. This. Do you need me to explain this? Anyone needs me to explain this again?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am, it's clear.
Yes, ma'am. Explain it clearly.
No problem. See, I have 1 million elements. That is given. Within 1 million elements, I want to perform my comparison. Correct? So, n is what? 1 million? I can write that as 10 to the power 6. Correct? Because there are 6 zeros. Yes or no? Whoever is asking me
yes,
to
ma'am.
Explain again. Respond, okay? So n is 10 to the power 6. Now, what is my direct formula to find the total number of comparisons? Half into n into n minus 1?
Yes, ma'am.
N is 10 to the power 6. So what will I get? Half into 10 to the power 6 into 10 to the power 6 minus 1?
Yes,
right? Ma'am. Now, 10 to the power 6, how can I write it? 10 into 10 to the power 5, this much I can write. Correct?
Yes.
This
yes.
is the same thing. So in next step, I cancel out 2 and this 10. And I get a 5 here. And I decide that this 1 that I'm subtracting from 10 lakhs or 1 million, if I ignore this 1, it won't really affect much. Okay. It won't affect the performance that much.
Yes, ma'am.
So I am ignoring this 1. And that is why I'm putting this approximation sign. Okay. So what do I have now on the final result of total number of comparisons? Approximately 5 into 10 to the power 11. Correct? 10 to the power 5 here, 10 to the power 6 here, so 5 plus 6, 11. But in my question, I'm given that my computer can only perform 10 to the power 8 comparisons per second. So how much time will it take to perform this number of comparisons? 5 into 10 to the power 11? 5 into 10 to the power 11 by 10 to the power 8? Unitary method?
Yes.
If in 1 second, if I do this many, so this many I will do in how many seconds? This by this? So this will cancel out. 10 to the power 11 by 10 to the power 8 will give 10 cube. So 5 into 10 cube is 5,000 seconds.
Yes, ma'am.
Clear?
Yes.
Yeah. Everyone? Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
If you can solve this type of questions on your own, you'll be fine in quiz. Okay? Okay, let's check the answers. Okay. All right. Any question from activity 4.3 or next one?
Next one.
Okay. So here I have done all the questions. No problem. You will solve them. How many? Okay. Assume that we have 20 objects that need to be compared. 20 objects that I need to compare. Okay. How many pairwise comparisons do we need to make? If each object is compared with every other object exactly once. Solve it. 20 objects. N is what?
N is 20.
20. How many roll number of comparisons? Half into?
Half into 20 into 19.
Correct.
90.
It is 190.
190.
No, it is 190. See, this is 19 into 20 by
3. Right?
Right?
Yeah.
Do this. So 19 into 10, 190. That is the answer of the first one. Second one, assume that we can distribute the 20 objects into bins of equal size. If we go with 4 bins, how many comparisons will we have to make overall? Let's solve this. So now I have n equals
to... question.
Yeah, I will tell you here.
Sure.
I will tell you the question. Okay, since I have just written the answer, let me just say it here. So I have a total of 20 objects. And I have 4 bins. Yes. So k is 4. All bins are of equal size, it is given.
Ma'am.
Okay. So it is asking me if I divide it into bins, then how many comparisons will I need? Now you tell me the formula. Or however you want to solve, you can solve.
5 objects in each bin.
Ma'am, replace n by n by k. Ma'am, we can simply replace the n by n by k.
Exactly. Just replace the n by k and what? Multiply by k. Right at the end,
n by k.
Because when you replace with n by k, you are just finding for one bin.
Yes.
And I need for k bins, right? So for one bin, my formula is half into n by k minus 1. Correct. And I will multiply by k because I need for all k bins. So 4 into half into n by k is what? 5? 4, 20 by 4?
Yes.
So 5 into 5 minus 1. Solve this. 5 into 4 is 20. 20 by 2 is 10. 10 into 4 is 40. Right? This expression you can solve, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So you got 40. So that is your answer. Next is... this one I have intentionally written a wrong answer here. You will find the right one. We distribute the 20 objects into bins of equal size. Okay, again, bins of equal size is given. But how many bins should we choose to make the least number of comparisons overall? Tell me.
10.
Okay, very good. Anyone else disagree?
Let me solve. Want to make 0 bin, it's possible. Is it possible
if
it to make
will
0
be
bin?
10, then in each bin there will be 2 cards, so the comparison will be easier.
Yeah, and anyone thinks that it should be 20 number of bins?
No, ma'am.
Otherwise,
why not?
We will have nothing to be compared. Everyone
exactly.
will have one.
Yeah, so basically, if I take k equals to 20, so each bin will only have n by k will become 1. Right, so each bin will only have 1 card, so no comparisons will occur. But I need the least number of overall comparisons. What will be the least when every bin has 2 cards? Right? So every bin will have 2 cards when n by k becomes 10. That means n is 20, so k has to be what? 2. N by 2, n by k will be 2. Right? So n is 20,
but
so k will be 10. K will be
10.
So 10 is the answer, right?
Yes.
Did I confuse anyone? Do I need to tell it one more time?
No, ma'am, clear.
Okay. So this answer won't be 20, it will be 10. I did this because I only made the mistake when I was first looking into it. I thought that, okay, if I'm distributed into 20 bins, it will be the least. But then I realized that, then there will be no comparison as well. I need least number of comparison. Comparison will happen when I have more than 1 card. Okay. So based on questions 1 and 3, by what factor does binning reduce the number of comparisons? Tell me. What is the factor?
Again, question number 3.
90 by 10, 19.
Yeah. Why?
19, ma'am.
Why? Because in question number 1 is clear. This is the total number of comparisons. And I need the number of comparisons from question number 3. Right? So question number 3, I have 10 bins. Within each bin, I have 2 cards. So how many maximum comparisons within one bin? 1? See, within each bin, how many comparisons will I have? Half into 2 into 2 minus 1? Right?
1.
Because n by k is 2.
Yes, ma'am.
So this is what? 1. So total, how many comparisons do I have? 10.
10.
Right? 10 bins. So k into this 1, that is 10. So what is my factor? What was the factor? Total number of comparisons without binning by total number of comparisons with binning. So 190 by 10 is what? 19?
Yes,
ma'am. Clear, yes, everyone?
Ma'am.
Yeah. Next is, we want to find the number of, give me one second. Huh? Okay. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Let's take question 5 now. So we want to find the number of pairs of students to satisfy both the conditions given below. What is condition 1? Both students in the pair have the same total marks. And both students do not belong to the same gender. So now I want to find all such pairs of students who have the same total marks but not the same gender. So we now divide the students into 2 bins. And what is my criteria? One which contains the boys, other which contains the girls. So gender is my criteria based on which I'm dividing the students into bins. One for boys, one for girls. And perform pairwise comparison within the bins. Okay. So will this approach give us the correct answer for the number of pairs? If I just compare within the bins, will that give me the correct answer?
No, ma'am.
Why?
Ma'am, it's not essential that only girls have the same marks. Like we are the first condition is pair have the same total marks. So if we are going for pair, it may be a boy and other girls have the same marks.
See, first of all, you don't even have to think that much. Just go through both the conditions. What is the first condition? They must have same total marks. What is the second condition? They must not belong to the same gender. So if I divide it into like gender-wise categories, then obviously in those categories, the second condition will never be satisfied. I'm only comparing boy with boy and girl with girl. So this will never give us the correct answer, right? This approach. Rather, if I distributed them in terms of similar marks, whoever has got same marks, right? That could maybe give, even that is not the correct approach. Maybe some other criteria is there. Say, maybe if I distributed my cards according to...
Ma'am, please tell me the question number 4.
What if you look?
5. Can you see my screen? It is on the screen.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, the whole idea of binning is like to lesser down the hassle, right?
To reduce the number of comparisons.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Okay. So there can be one way to solve this. We can divide the cards based on some other criteria. Maybe we can divide the cards according to city or town. Okay. In that case, we know that whatever town a person is belonging from, like both girls and boys can belong from one town, right? That way I can check. Or some other criteria. Actually, there is even this is not a good criteria for this question. There can be some criteria based on which if I check, I will get, like, what is the idea? It is that gender should be equally distributed in the bins. Then only I can find, right, the pairs. If one bin has only boys, one bin has only girls, then I will never find the desired pair, right? Or maybe you can decide, see, this can be one good thing. Maybe we can keep the criteria as, say, all students that have got less than 200 come in one bin, all students that have gone greater than 200 in total marks can come under another bin. So now if I compare, will I get that boy-girl pair who have scored total marks? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Now there's a probability, right? So this is how you can do it. But this approach is wrong. So it will be no. Now we have data about the birth dates, that is year, month, date of 100 people in a room. We wish to find the number of pairs of people who were born in the same year. Which is the most ideal binning strategy? Tell me, out of these three. So what we are trying to find is, we are trying to find the number of pairs of people, that is two people pairs. Okay. We are trying to find the number of pairs of people who were born in same year. And what is my N? 100. I have a total set of 100 people. So what will be the most ideal binning strategy? Tell me. See the three options.
Use 12 bin, one for each decade starting from year 1900.
Okay. Anyone else?
Second option. Use two bins. Second. One per people born before the year.
Second option.
I also thought for second, but maybe 12 bins will be more helpful than two bins.
When you see this type of question, what is the first thing you must check? What is the most ideal strategy? We need to reduce the number of comparisons as much as we can. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So what does that mean? When will the number of comparisons be the least? When every bin contains the least number of cards? Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So in which of these options will that happen? Okay, let's take option A. Use 12 bins, one for each month. We all know that this will give what? This will give a huge number of people for each month, right? Yes. But actually, this is not, at least we can say that this is not optimal, because like 100 people, right? 100 people, and they can be born, like there could be 10 in each month or whatever. Not 10, say 9 in each month can happen.
Year is not set
from when to when.
Yeah.
Our aim is to reduce the bin size or reduce the comparison. Like if
reduce the number of
comparison.
Comparisons. That is the goal. So if you want to reduce the number of comparisons, what does that mean? You need to reduce the number of elements in each bin, because within each bin again you have to compare. So main goal is to reduce the number of elements in each bin, right? Ultimately, that is what it comes down to.
For each month.
So here, when you do this for each month, first of all, it will be messed up because year is also given. So people from different years will also be in the same month, right? Someone born in 1980, someone born in 1990, both born in December. So they both come under one pile. And I am doing meaningless comparisons because those two people will never have the same birth date. Correct. So categorizing by month is not possible here. It's not feasible. It will not give the right answer. Correct? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
You understood the reason, right? Because people from different years can be born.
We have to find the number
year.
Of years of people who are born in year.
Yeah. So year also needs to be taken into account here. So first option is a no. Second option. I want two bins, one for people born before 2000, one for people born after 2000. Worst case is what? What is the worst case that can happen? Okay, what are the cases that can happen? See, in this second option, what are the cases? One thing can happen. The extreme case is, say only one person was born after 2000 and other 99 people were born before 2000. So in that case, in your one bin only, you have 99 people. How many comparisons does that come to? 99 into 98 by 2. That is a huge number, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And in one other, you don't need to perform any comparison at all. That is not a good thing. That is not a good distribution. Another thing can happen that both might have 50-50 people. Even then, it's still a big number, 50 into 49 by 2. That too twice for two bins. Right. But if you use 12 bins, come to the third option, 12 bins, one for each decade starting from the year 1900. This is a good distribution. Right. Because in this distribution, what is the worst thing that can happen? We have 12 bins and 100 people. Why saying 12 bins for each decade? 12 bins means how many years? 120 years then. So let us take that the data set is taking people from 1900 to 2020. Right. 1900 to 2020. Correct. 120 years.
See, 12 bins, one for each decade. That means each bin is taking people from a decade. That is over a period of 10 years.
Yes.
So 12 bins means over a period of 120 years?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Correct? So that is a much better distribution, because in this it can happen that 100 people, it can be a good distribution over 12 bins. So in worst case, there will be 9 people. Sorry, in best case, there will be 9 people per bin. Correct? 9 or 8. I think 8, 96, yeah.
8.
Right? So best case will be 8 people per bin.
12, no, ma'am, at most.
Yeah, I mean, 8 people, just take it like approximation, 100 people. So 12 bins. So if I try to distribute uniformly, it will be around 8 people per bin.
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And worst case can be what? That maybe in some decades, more people were born than other decades. But yes, still, ma'am, then it is a good distribution compared to the other two. Right? Yes, so the first distribution is wrong by itself. It is meaningless. Second distribution is possible. You can do it. But it will take a lot more number of comparisons because there are only two bins. But the third one gives you a good number of bins and a good distribution. So third one will be the correct answer. Understand, everyone, why third option? It is asking you the most ideal winning strategy. Even you can use option two also, but it is not an ideal strategy. That's it.
Because we can get maximum comparisons.
Yeah. When you take two bins, it means, I told you, the worst case will be when there are 99 people in one bin and one person in the other. It's a huge number of comparison.
Okay, so whenever we see maximum bins and less observations.
No, not always. You have to check all the options and compare, like I compared. It's not always at the maximum number of bins. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I say that I am taking like 50 bins say I'm doing some distribution from year 1900 to 2020 where I take 50 bins and categorize people in it. That is not good. Why do I need to iterate that many times?
Yeah.
When I can do it with 12 bins, look at how many, what is your N? Your N is 100. A good distribution can be around where each bin will have like 8-9 people. That is a good distribution. Now you have to compare that in your mind. Obviously will give you such options where the comparison will be very drastic. Like in this one, it is a drastic comparison. First option you can neglect totally, because we know that monthly, if we do it, we will never get people with same birthdays. Very rare, right? Because people from different years might have birthdays in the same month. So that is not at all a good distribution. That those will be meaningless comparisons, right? Because we have to take the year into account as well. So first option, you can scratch it. Second and third was the main confusion. But second option, you can see only two bins. And you can already check that if it has only two bins, then what is the worst case? Okay, let's just calculate this now. 99 and 1, right? 99 in bin A, 1 in bin B. So how many total? Half into 99 into 98. Plus, for this one, no comparison, so 0. So this will give me, calculate this, someone. 99 into 49. Okay. But if I take that strategy, third one, where I have 12 bins, and what will be my best case? If I have, say, 8 people per bin, 96. Yeah, I just approximated. I'm not taking 100, I'm saying 96 people. Okay. Then what will be my total number of comparisons? 12 into half into 8 into 7. That is 48 into 7. So which one is better? Which one is less number of? This one?
Yeah.
Correct? Ma'am. Way better than this one?
Yes, ma'am.
That is how you compare. Okay. Obviously, we won't give you some question where all the options will be very confusing. This type of questions will be given where you can easily compare. Okay. Any question from activity 4.4?
And fifth one, if you can, one more.
Yeah, sure. See. So what is that? We are given two conditions, right? So we want to find pairs of students where either where both the conditions must be satisfied. So both students must have the same total marks and both students must not belong to the same gender. That is, both cannot be boy-boy or girl-girl. It must be a boy-girl pair. Okay, these are my two conditions and both must be satisfied. So now it is saying we divide the students into two bins, one of which contains boys and the other one contains girls. And after this, we perform pairwise comparisons within the bins, just like however how we compare within each bin. So will this approach give us the correct answer? See, first you can say no based on one simple thing. You have categorized the students into bins based on gender. One bin only has boys, one bin only has girls. But your sole condition was this: both students do not belong to the same gender. Now you are not comparing across bins, you are comparing within a bin, right? So whenever you compare, you are either comparing boys or comparing girls. You are not comparing boy and girl, right?
But we can also compare across bins.
No, we don't do that. Did we do that till now?
Why don't we do that?
That is the whole purpose of bins. You take some criteria and you categorize so that your number of comparisons lessen. If we compare across the bins, then what is the point of binning? We categorize so that we don't have to compare within a large set of data.
Okay.
So if I have 9 people, I'm binning into 3 people. Now if I do that across the bins, it will just give me the same number of comparison, right? 36. But I am trying to lessen it. I just have to compare within each bin. So if I do that here, just compare within the boy bin or just compare within the girl bin, I will never get that condition satisfied where I will get a boy-girl pair, right?
Yeah.
So that is why it's wrong. It will not. It is not the correct approach. Correct?
Yeah.
So what can be a correct approach? That also I said. Say, if I have only two bins, I can categorize it like, one bin contains all people who have total marks less than 200 and the other bin contains all people who have marks greater than 200. Now in these bins, if I compare, I will find such pairs because there are both boys and girls present, right, in each bin.
I'll repeat once again this one.
See, I can have two bins A and B, where A is for people who have total marks X less than 200 and B has total marks X greater than 200. Now these files will have both boys and girls. Here I can compare, right? So this is a good approach, but that one isn't. Any other queries? 4.4. No one?
No, ma'am.
Should I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let's go to 4.5. So we have two students, X and Y. Who satisfy? So this is the concept of that fair teams concept.
No, ma'am.
Not yet.
Okay. So basically, what we do is we try to find such pairs. Okay, we try to find such pairs where the total marks is similar, but the marks in any two subjects is opposite. Like if someone has scored 200, if say two people have scored 210, okay. Now one of them, if they are in a pair in this fair teams concept, then one of them must have scored good marks in maths but bad marks in physics. But the other person must have scored good marks in physics but bad marks in maths. So the equilibrium is maintained. Understood? This is the basic concept. Everyone clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So based on this only, this whole thing is happening. These questions are coming from. But I can solve these questions with you. You will understand, no problem. But go through this lecture. Okay, concept of fair teams. It is it is discussed in much more better detail.
Yes, ma'am.
So what is the first question? We have two students, X and Y, who satisfy the following condition. X plus maths plus x dot maths plus x dot physics equals to y dot maths plus y dot physics. What do you understand from this?
Ma'am, total number of both the student in maths and physics are same.
No. We have two students, X and Y.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is not total number of students. I am asking, this is saying that both the students have scored the same marks when we take their physics and math marks together.
Yes, ma'am.
That comparison we are doing.
Yes.
So which of the following scenarios are possible? This you can answer without any knowledge. If you just know the concept of, you know, greater and lesser numbers, that is enough to solve this. So is this possible ever, where X has scored more marks in Y than in maths also and in physics also? Then is this possible?
No, ma'am. It's not possible.
It's not possible.
No, ma'am. No.
Okay. So then total marks of X should be higher than total marks of Y, right? So option A is wrong. Okay. Now, if they have both scored equal in maths and physics, that is possible?
Yes, ma'am.
That is X has scored, say, X has scored 15 maths, Y has also scored 15 maths. X has scored 19 physics, Y has also scored 19 physics. That is a possibility. Next is, if X has scored greater than Y in maths but less than Y in physics, is this possible?
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, the other one is also possible. That is, X has scored less than Y in maths but greater than Y in physics. That is the concept of fair teams.
Mm-hmm.
That is, they have a similar total, but they might have performed good in one subject, bad in the other subject. Now, this combination of subjects should be opposite.
Yes.
Understood. That is, if someone has scored better in maths, then the other person must have scored bad in maths. And if someone has scored bad in physics, the other person should be scored better in physics. That's the thing. Very easy. So these three will be the options, correct? Any doubt?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. Now we wish to count the number of students in bin 201 to 225, endpoints included. What is 201 to 225? It is the total marks scored. Okay. Endpoints included means 201 and 225 themselves are also included. Okay, in the range. And store the result in a variable A. All right. So we are counting the number of students in the bin to where students that have scored total marks from 200 to 225 are present. Correct. And we are storing that value where? In variable A. Now, which of the following if conditions checks if a given card X falls in this range? So variable A has been initialized to 0. What is your job? You have to find the correct if statement to categorize. So this is asking for binning condition. Okay. Binning condition, not comparison. Understood, everyone? Let's take the first option. So endpoints included, that is an important thing. That is 201 and 225 must also be present in the range. So first option is, if X dot total falls within the range where it is greater than equal to 201 and less than equal to 225, then A will be assigned 1. Is this correct?
No.
A has been initialized to 0.
Always assigned A to 1, not increase.
Yeah. So it won't count the number of students, right? So it's wrong.
Mm.
Next is, the if remains same, but A equals to A plus 1.
Yes,
is this correct?
It is incremental.
So A gets updated every time such a student comes in with total in this range?
Yes, ma'am.
Next is, A is incrementing. But here, what is wrong?
Range is
the endpoints are not included?
This is wrong.
It's correct. Yeah. It is correct, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
One second.
Because the range is less than 200.
It is greater than X.total less than 226. If this was 201 and 225, then it will be wrong.
Yes.
This is correct. Because it is including the endpoints, right? 201 is included when we say greater than 200.
Yes.
So this option. Last is this. If X.total is greater than equal to 201, then I have a nested if. Only if this condition satisfies, then I go into the nested if and check if X dot total is less than equal to 225. If both the conditions satisfied, then I do update X A equals to A plus 1. So all three are correct. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Let me just check the answers once still. Yeah, all three are correct. Okay, now here. This one. Consider an arbitrary team represented by XY and consider the following procedure. What is the procedure name? Is left heavy. Means what? Left heavy means that the parameter in the left, that is M in this case. M comes on the left, right? M comma N. M is on the left. So left heavy means that M has a greater total than N. Okay. That is the meaning behind the name. So is left heavy does what? It checks if the total score of M is greater than N. If so, it will return true. If not, it will return false. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So when, so the question is left heavy XY returns the value false, which one of the scenarios are possible? If both X and Y have scored equal total marks, then what will happen? Say both have scored 210. So then in the first if block, M dot total minus N dot total becomes zero. Is zero greater than zero?
No.
No, ma'am.
So it will go to the else block.
Yes.
Print what? False.
Yes.
So option A is correct. If X's marks is greater than Y, then M dot total minus N dot total will be something greater than zero, right? It will return true. So it will be false option. Now the last option is total marks of Y is greater than that of X. So if M dot total minus N dot total gives a negative score, right? That is Y has scored greater than X or N has scored greater than M. Then it will go to the else block, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
So options A and C. Now four. Question four is the following statement true or false? The return value of is left heavy XY is always the opposite of the return value of is left heavy YX. Is this true?
Yes, no, ma'am.
Take a very simple example.
No. Say zero X and zero.
Yeah, exactly. Take 1, 0. So if X is 100 and Y is 0, then if I perform is left heavy, it will do what? First, I am taking 100 and 0. So 100 minus 0 is greater than 0, so it will return true. But if I do this, reverse it, then 0 and 100, 0 minus 100, it will return false, correct? So it will always be the opposite of the return value. But that is not true, right?
And when both are equal marks, having equal marks, then
so both when not both, opposite. Yeah, yes, you're right. So when both are taking equal marks, like when both have 100 scores, say, so 100 minus 100, right? In that case,
false to zero, then again it will become false.
But again, when you reverse it, it is still 100 minus 100, so it will again return false. So not in all cases, right? So this will be false.
Ma'am, they don't get confused.
Yeah, see. XY is some arbitrary team. So arbitrary means it is saying that the return value of is left heavy XY is always the opposite of the return value of is left heavy YX. That means if is left heavy XY is giving true, it is left heavy YX will always give false. Is that right? No. Because when you take the case where X and Y have scored equal total marks, then what will happen?
Oh,
it will always return false.
In this case, yes.
That's why
yes.
It will be false, right? Okay. Number five is, what is the procedure doing? Check. So this is a mystery procedure, which is taking the parameters M comma N. If is left heavy MN equals to false, right? Then it is coming into one more nested loop, where it is taking if is left heavy NM equals to false. If both the conditions are false, when will both the conditions be false? We just saw when M and N are equal, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So when M and N are equal, both M comma N and N comma N will give false. So only then both of the if blocks will be satisfied and it will return true. Otherwise, it returns false.
Yes.
So what is it checking? Ma'am. It is checking if M has total, the same total marks as N.
Then that after else again it has written else.
Yeah, so this is the else for the nested if, right? So is left heavy N comma N, for this else is there, return false. But the outer is left heavy M comma N, for this also an else block is here. So if the condition becomes true here only, then only you can come to the else block and return false, right?
Yes, ma'am.
That's it.
Excuse me, ma'am. Hello, I'm audible.
Yeah, yeah. Go on.
Hello.
Go on. Yeah, you're audible.
Ma'am, my near exam city preference, I am choosing Allahabad, ma'am. But in my dashboard, shows Odisha, Sambalpur, and second city preference is Chhattisgarh, Raipur.
Okay. So,
how to edit, ma'am? I am choose Allahabad, but it shows Sambalpur, Odisha.
Okay, listen. If you're not able to edit it, then you can write a mail to the support team. They will change it, okay, if possible.
But ma'am, I am applying September batch, but some issue. I can't write qualifier exam. So I can reply in January batch. I am selected Allahabad, but it shows only Chhattisgarh, Raipur, and Odisha, Sambalpur.
You just write a mail to course support team, okay? Just write a mail to support team. They will answer. They will solve your problem.
But ma'am, support team response in 3 or 4 days. Our exam is on head, ma'am.
Okay. Then
hall ticket.
Then
release.
You.
Okay.
Just do one thing. Do this. Post it on Discourse, okay? Tag me or Piyush sir, anyone, and post it on Discourse. We will check what we can do. If it can be changed,
please,
it
ma'am.
Will be changed. Otherwise, you have to give it in that city only, wherever it is allocated. We'll try to change it.
Ma'am, I am in Uttar Pradesh and my city preference is Allahabad, but it is Odisha, ma'am. It is very, very...
Okay. You write a post on Discourse. We'll see what we can do, okay?
So far, ma'am.
Okay. No problem. You just write the post as soon as possible and tag me or Piyush sir. Tag us both, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
And you also write a mail to the support team.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Exam city is not reflecting for us right now.
Yes, ma'am. My also exam
okay,
is not
okay. We'll take all of this at the end of class, please. Not now. Let us complete what we were studying first, then. Yeah, tell me. Anyone has problem? Anything in activity 4.5?
This question,
which one?
No, ma'am.
This one, fifth one.
Will it be graded assignment also?
Sorry.
Week three. Will you discuss the graded assignment week three?
If you have any doubts, then yeah, I'll try to take them if time is there.
Okay.
Otherwise, you again have a session for CT tomorrow, and week four not much is left, right? So
yes,
there
ma'am.
Also you can discuss in tomorrow's session.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So you want me to discuss question 5 again?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, this is a mystery procedure. Okay. It is taking two parameters, M and N. M and N is nothing but total marks of two students. Okay. First thing it does is it runs an if block where it is checking if left heavy M comma N. If that returns false, only then it will go into the nested if. So is left heavy M comma N does what? It checks if M has scored more greater total marks than N, right? If so, then it returns true. But if M has scored less total marks than N, or if M and N have equal scores, then it will return false, correct?
Yeah.
So consider that it has returned false. Then it enters this nested if. In nested if, it again checks is left heavy N comma N. Now it reverses the parameters. By reversing the parameter also, if I get a false result, then it returns true. Now when will I get a false result by reversing?
Take one value or two values of M and N.
See, this will happen only in case of equal. Okay. See, this is the is left heavy procedure, right? Now here, if M and N both have scored, say 100, okay?
Yeah.
Then it goes into the if block. And it will see that is 100 minus 100 greater than 0? 0 is not greater than 0, so it will return false. Correct? It will go into the else block.
Mm-hmm.
Because if condition is not satisfied.
Yeah.
Right? So that is just like that. Here also, in such a case, the first if block will be satisfied. Because here we are checking whether it is returning false or not. So for equal values of M and N, it will return false.
Yeah.
And only for equal values, this nested if will also return false. Because in case of equal values, whether you reverse the parameters or not, it will always return false. Because this will never be greater than zero, so it is no chance of returning true.
So the the pseudocode is valid only for if the both the total are same.
It is asking that what the procedure is doing. So it is checking if M has scored same total marks as N.
So both can be false only if the total are same.
Yeah. Otherwise, both will never be. See, yeah. If M is greater than N, then it will return true. Then only the outside if is not satisfied. But if M is less than N, then it returns false. So outside if is satisfied. But I come into the inner if block, and I reverse the procedure. I reverse the parameters. So now N is greater than M. That will return true.
Okay.
So this will not be satisfied, right?
Okay.
Only for equal. Clear?
Clear.
Okay. So any question from activity 4.5? Anything? Yes, no, say something.
No, it's clear. No doubts.
No doubt.
Okay, thanks. So activity 6. Okay. Before you solve this activity, watch this lecture. It is based on procedure to find the same date of birth for different students. Okay, again, that date of birth thing is coming back. So let us see what is the code block given. X and Y be the cards of two. Let X and Y be the cards of two students. Okay. Now let's see if these two code blocks do the exact same thing or not. In the first code block, we are matching their date of birth. We are comparing. If date of birth of X is equal to date of birth of Y, then we return true. Otherwise, we return false. So if they are both born on the same date, then it will return true. Otherwise, false. Code block 2 does what? If X dot date of birth is not equal to Y dot date of birth, then it will return false. Otherwise, it returns true. So are these two equivalent?
Yes, ma'am.
Same thing, right? Just it is reversing the comparison operator, yes. And it is putting false here instead of true. Because yes. If it is returned, you have if it is reversed, you have to reverse the return value also, right?
Yes.
So yes will be the answer. Second question, same birthday. Now we have a procedure called same birthday, where we take the parameters X and P. X is what? A card, and P is what? A pile of cards. Okay, these are the parameters. So it returns the value true if there is at least one person in the pile whose date of birth matches with X. Also, the procedure returns the pile in exactly the same way that it was passed. So usually what happens if you take a block of cards, right? If you take a deck of cards and you, distribute the cards and then again put them back, it will be in reverse order, right? When you put it back. Right?
Yes.
If you go through the lectures, you'll see how professor distributes the cards, like when he checks. The deck is reversed. Right. So yes. We here have condition that the pile must be returned to us after the procedure exactly in the same way that it was passed. Okay. And what is the procedure doing? It is taking one card and a pile of cards as parameter. One thing you must know is that card that we are taking, it must not be present in the pile because no self comparisons. Correct?
Yes,
okay. So yes, it will return the value true if there is at least one person in the pile whose date of birth matches with X. Now see the code. Now statement 1 is some statement that we have to find out. Next statement is while more cards in pile 1 and found equals to false. So we know now that found is some variable, right? So both of these conditions have to be satisfied. Only then we'll move into the while block. Right? That is my pile must have more cards and found must have the value false. Right? Next, what we do, if it is true, we pick a card X from pile 1 and read that card and move it to pile 2. Now, in our if block, we write, check using this procedure. Same birthday, X, pile 1. Okay. So what does this do? You know what this procedure does. It is written that it will return true if there is at least one person in the pile 1 here whose date of birth matches with X. So if so, then some mysterious statement 2 is there. Now we wish to use this code to find if there is a pair of students in the database with the same birthday. The iteration terminates as soon as such a pair is found. That is, we are not trying to find the number of such pairs. We are trying to find whether there are any such pairs that exist or not. If we find it, we can end the termination. We can terminate the program. Okay? Clear? Problem statement?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, everyone? Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, what will be an ideal choice for statement one? What do you think?
Yes,
found should be true or false or none.
Ma'am, we have to initialize as false because in first condition we are going to search for the found equal yeah. false.
So if found is true, then it will never move into the while, right? Because then while will always be false.
Yes.
So found has to be initialized as false. That is the first question. Second question: which of the following is an ideal choice for statement true? Statement two. I'm sorry. So statement two represents what? It finds if there is any such pair where two students have the same birth date. So if so, then the program has to terminate immediately. Therefore, found has to be true. Because found, if it
yes,
is set
ma'am.
To true, then in the next iteration, it will never be. It will never satisfy the while condition again, right?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
So found has to be true in statement two.
Yes.
Everyone understood? Response, please. Only one person is responding.
No, ma'am. What is the question asking for?
See, our goal is we are.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I have another class, Python.
Yeah, yeah,
there
no
is
problem.
A Python
you can
class.
Leave. No problem. I just have one more activity
yes,
question left
thank
because
you.
In activity 7, there is just one question. So that I will discuss, and you can see that in the recording. Okay.
This is being
right.
recorded.
You can find the YouTube link, right?
Okay.
You can find the YouTube link in your calendar. Okay. I will update the link for that YouTube video in the calendar. You can watch it from there also. Okay. So, yeah, who was asking?
Me, ma'am.
Okay. See. So my problem is saying that I have a deck of cards. Okay. From there, I pick one card X and I have the rest of the cards in pile one. So my goal is to check using this same birthday procedure where I pass this X and pile one as parameters. The same birthday does what? It checks if there is any such student present in pile one who has same birthday as X. Okay. If so, it will return true. If not, it will return false. So that is my goal. Now, in this code snippet, you have to find what will be statement one and what will be statement two. One more thing is that as soon as we find one such pair of people having the same birthday, the program needs to terminate. We are not counting the number of such pairs. We are trying to find if any such pair exists. Okay, clear?
Only once.
Yeah, only once. As soon as it encounters.
So even
one
if we
pair,
have two cards with same, it will not go. Will not count.
Even that. If we have two pairs of people having same birthday, will not count that. As soon as we find one pair, we will terminate the program because our question is asking: is there any such pair that exists? So yeah, once we find a pair, we can say yes, there is. That's it. I don't need to count. Okay.
Okay.
So now I want to find what will be statement one, what will be statement two. So statement one, what is the ideal value? Can I set found to true?
No, ma'am.
Because then while condition will never be true and we'll never be able to check for this birthday condition, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Because found equals to false is one of the while conditions. So found has to be set to false initially. Okay. Found is initialized to false so that we can start the iterations. Clear? I'm asking that boy who was asking.
Yes, ma'am.
How, ma'am? Why to initialize it false?
See, okay. Let's say you initialize it to true. Okay. Then okay. What will happen? Next line, while more cards in pile one and found equals to false. So will found be false? So it will never be true. It will never be false if I initialize it to true. Because there is nothing else happening before this line.
If initially found is true, then we'll go to the while section. So while section says if more cards in pile one and found is equal to false.
Only then it will move into the iteration.
So the while condition will be false.
Yeah. So it will never even start the program if I initialize found to true.
Yeah.
That is why found must be initialized to false. Correct? So statement one is find found equals to false. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Statement two now. So if same birthday x comma file one, what will be the statement here? Now, what is my condition? That once I find any such pair, I need to terminate the program. When will the termination happen? When this while loop fails to iterate? When will the while loop fail to iterate? When found is not false anymore?
Yeah.
Or I have run out of all cards?
Yeah.
Right? But of course, there are pairs of people. So I won't run out of cards. I will encounter one such pair. Right?
Yeah.
So once I encounter that pair, found must be set to true so that the next iteration never happens and program terminates.
Yeah.
That is why found equals to true. Second statement. Okay. Clear?
Yeah, the third one is clear, but I'm still not convinced.
This one.
Second.
Yes. Second one. Yeah, I understood you're not convinced. See, if I put found equals to true. Okay. I'm initializing found to true. Then I'm coming to this while loop. And I'm checking. More cards in pile one? Yes, I have more cards. But I have one more condition that also needs to be satisfied before I do anything else. Because there is an AND condition. If this was OR, I wouldn't care. As long as there are more cards, this while loop will continue. But AND. So both conditions need to be satisfied. So it will check, is found equal to false? So it will never be false if I initialize it to true. Right?
Mm-hmm.
The first iteration only will never happen.
Mm-hmm.
That is why you have to start from false. Okay.
So why do I even need to go to the rest of the block?
Otherwise, how will you iterate? If you don't, if this while block, this while conditions are not satisfied, you won't be able to pick a card from pile one, move to pile two, check the procedure, nothing, none of this will happen. It won't even enter the while block as long as these conditions are not satisfied.
Okay. Okay. Got it.
Okay. So whenever you run a while loop, you first have to satisfy the condition. Then only the iteration will happen, whatever is inside the block.
Yeah. In order to check if that card have the same birthday with the...
Yeah. Whatever our goal is, nothing will be accomplished as long as we enter the while block.
Yeah. And to in enter order the to while like, block, get to that result, we need to go to the... We need to do something.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, got it.
Clear now? No more confusion, right? No second guessing. You have to be firm about your answer. Clear? Yes or no? If you want...
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
No, that boy who was asking.
Yeah, I'm clear.
Who is it? Aryan?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Next. Okay. So, activities 4.6. Any question left? Anything you want to ask?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Let's go to 4.7. This is the last activity. Good for you. It only has one question. Okay. So, before this activity, you need to watch the lecture 4.7 because there you will see what they're trying to do is, see, if you have the paragraph words data set, you can see, okay, let me open that data set for you. It's in the common data. Okay, this is the paragraph words data set, right? So if you see each of these words, you will see it looks something like this. Yeah. So there are one words like this, right? It. Then there is some word was. So once you arrange these words one after another, you get a whole paragraph, right? A meaningful paragraph. So it is from this data set that these questions are being asked. So basically what it is asking is, whenever you encounter this paragraph, you will see that there are lots of pronouns there, right? Like he, him, she, her, these are pronouns, right? So whenever you encounter a pronoun, to find who that pronoun belongs to, like there is a, some person called Swaminathan in those cards. So whenever we are referring to him as he or his, any pronoun is being used, and I want to find that, say I randomly picked that he card, and I want to find whose pronoun is that. Then what do I have to do? I have to go in reverse order of the cards and find out the last proper noun or the last name of a person that was encountered, right? That will usually be the case that, yeah, this pronoun is being used for him, correct? We never just out of the blue do we ever say that he lives in Kolkata. We don't, right? We first say who that person is. Say I am talking about some guy called Rahul. So I said that Rahul studies in class 10. He lives in Kolkata, right? This makes sense. So now if I encounter that he and I trace back my each word in reverse order, then I will eventually reach Rahul in the first sentence, correct? Are you understanding?
No, ma'am. Look.
Say I have a sentence. Rahul studies in class 10. And then I have he lives in Kolkata. Okay. This can be one of like the paragraph words data set. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So when I encounter this he, say I am, say this 1-1 words are written on 1-1 card. Okay. This is the order in which I have the card. First I have Rahul, then I have studies, then I have in, then I have class, then I have 10, like this. Okay. So I am, how will I find out? I will just go in reverse order of the cards that I have visited till now.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I will trace it back to Rahul. Like as soon as I encountered the person, like the name of a person, I'll know that, yeah, I've been referring to him. Correct? In
yes,
most
ma'am.
Cases, not in all cases. See, why? Because it can happen that there could be like more than one pronoun, okay, and more than one name. In that case, it gets a little complicated. So to see one such example, you need to watch lecture 4.7. Okay. There it is given. But for now, understand this much, that this is how we are tracing. So it is asking, does the paragraph words dataset provide the information of personal nouns or pronouns to resolve pronoun with its equivalent matching noun? Does it? Okay. It won't. But to understand this question better, you need to watch that lecture. So what it does is basically, see, we were talking about Swaminathan, okay, in that part. Okay. So it can happen that, 1 second, let me take that example.
In this example,
yeah,
the one which you written, can you frame that question the similar to this
question, right?
Yeah,
that is what I'm trying to do. So it can be that okay, let me think. So Rahul studies in class 10, he lives in Kolkata. Next I might have something called like I might be referring to some other person using a he, okay, who has been mentioned earlier. There was one, okay, let me go through these cards once, okay, then I can find that it is the proper example. Oh, I just turned it off now. 1 second. Just give me a minute, okay? Let me find that data set. Yeah, these are the data sets. Okay. But is there a PDF version of this data set available? Do you know? Is there a PDF? Yeah, it is. Okay, is my screen visible?
No, ma'am.
All right. Okay. No?
Yeah.
Now, okay. Okay, now check. This is the paragraph words data set, right? Let us go through it. So when do we encounter a pronoun? So first, it was Monday morning. Swaminathan was reluctant to open his eyes. So first is his, this one, right? This is a pronoun?
Yes, ma'am.
So if I want to find whose pronoun is that, I have to retrace back till I did Swaminathan, correct? Correct? Yes or no?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
After this, again, he considered Monday especially unpleasant in the calendar. After the delicious freedom of Saturday and Sunday, it was difficult to get into the Monday mood of work and discipline. He shuddered at the, again, this he, again a pronoun. I can trace it back to Swaminathan again, correct? Because no other names are there of people, see? Right? There are nouns, Saturday, Sunday, these are nouns, but these are not names of people. So you know that I'm not referring to that when I say he. Next, he shuddered at the very thought of school. The dismal yellow building, the fire-eyed Vedanayagam, his class teacher. Okay. So when we talk about this person, okay, his class teacher. Okay, if I take this his, this is a pronoun, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
But if I retrace this and try to find who this pronoun refers to, what is the first name that I will encounter? Vedanayagam, right? But is that who it is referring to?
No.
It is referring to Swaminathan, right?
Yes, ma'am.
In this approach, it won't be possible to find, right? So it works for some of the cases, but it doesn't work for all cases. This retracing.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is one such example. Clear? Like, see, another example if you take. His class teacher and headmaster with his thin long cane. Now this his, if I trace this back, this will go to Vedanayagam, which is correct, but this his should go to Swaminathan, correct?
Ma'am, it doesn't applies always.
Yeah, it doesn't apply always. So for some cases, like earlier in this here, when we encountered he and traced it back to Swaminathan, that was correct. But here if I encounter this his, it is still talking about Swaminathan, but the first name I am encountering is Vedanayagam, which is not correct.
So the question should be yes, right? That is the correct one.
Yeah, let me find the question. One second. So what the question is asking is, does the paragraph words data set provide information of personal nouns or pronouns to resolve pronoun with its equivalent matching noun? Does it always?
Even the question is not asking for always.
See, it is saying, does the paragraph words dataset provide information of personal nouns to resolve pronoun with its equivalent matching noun? So there is not even like, it was when it was talking about the headmaster, right? It didn't provide personal information regarding the headmaster itself, right? It first talked about Vedanayagam, said that it was his teacher, class teacher, and then it said it was his headmaster. So like whenever you are in, what this question is basically asking is, whenever you are encountering a pronoun, okay, if you retrace it back, will it always give you the equivalent personal noun?
No,
that is what the question is asking. So that is why I'm saying
question
that
should contain always, right?
Okay, here always is not given.
Yes.
Yeah, so that might be a little ambiguous actually. Does the paragraph first data set provide information? Maybe always would be a better addition to this question.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. But did you understand the problem?
Yeah, I got it.
Right? Okay. So I will, let me see if we can change this question later on. But yeah. Anyway, so these are all the activity questions for week 4. Any problem from anything? Anyone?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So next class, tomorrow, you can discuss practice assignment and any query you have from graded week 3. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
And if something remains unresolved, you can post it on Discord. We will answer. All right. So, what is your
okay,
job?
Ma'am, can you share this slide in the chat box?
All these are available
supplementary.
For you.
Okay, okay.
Supplementary contents, yeah. So what is your job for this week? Go through all the lectures, all the activity and practice questions, and then attempt the graded. Whatever query you have, post it on this course. And go through all the week 1 to week 4 contents for your quiz, okay?
Okay.
Solve all the questions one more time. Okay.
Ma'am, you will be taking tomorrow's class?
No, I won't be. I think Piyush sir will be taking. I have another class. Okay.
Ma'am, general doubt.
Yeah.
The term 1 students will also be attending this session.
Term students. Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone is attending.
So term 2, term 3, anyone?
Anyone who is taking CT is attending.
Why?
If you take CT, you are in foundation level. If you're in foundation level, you have to take CT, right?
Mm-hmm.
So everyone will join the class if they want to, of course. These are not mandatory sessions.
And what about for diploma level?
Diploma, you don't have CT, right?
I don't know.
CT is a foundation level course. You don't have CT in diploma.
Okay, so in foundation, how many terms do we have?
I am not the right person to ask this. You can ask Piyush sir, okay? He can better answer your question. No, qualified student does not have discourse access. You can post in that Google forum.
When will you get access to Discord? Discourse.
You will get access to discourse once you have qualified your this qualified exam and you are you get your official ID and everything.
Okay, someone said we'll get official ID after 1 term.
You will get once you're enrolled only then. Now you are studying for the qualify. You haven't passed it yet. So once you have done that and you are into foundation level, then you'll get your ID.
Okay, is this information totally correct? Because I have heard someone saying that
if you have any doubts, you can do one thing. Just ask Piyush sir, tag him on Discourse and ask him. He will answer all your queries. Okay.
I don't have Discourse.
Okay, Google forum also you can.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Please study well for your qualifiers, everyone.
Ma'am, I don't see any graded assignment solutions.
Graded assignment solutions are not there. No, we are uploading them every week. Can others see?
No, ma'am. No.
No, ma'am.
Okay, must be some issue with the dashboard portal. Okay, let me see. Let me check. We will make sure. Okay, it's available as soon as possible.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Thank you, everyone, for your time. Have a good night.
Good night, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good night, ma'am.